Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. The attack yesterday on the Hawaiian Islands has caused severe damage to American naval and military forces. I regret to tell you that very many American lives have been lost. I believe that I interpret the will of the Congress and of the people when I assert that we will not only defend ourselves to the uttermost, but will make it very certain that this form of treachery shall never again endanger us. There is no blinking at the fact that our people, our territory, and our interests are in grave danger. With confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph, so help us God.
The Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor brought World War II onto American soil and threatened the welfare of the United States. Just one day after the attack on Pearl Harbor, newspapers were filled with predictions of other impending Japanese assaults on the U.S. The tragedy experienced at Pearl Harbor and the predicted further endangerment of the U.S. acted as a catalyst for many young men to enlist. Enlisting was a way for young men to protect their country as well as show their patriotism. All across the country, in rural and urban communities alike, young men swamped military recruiting offices. Some stayed open 24 hours, 7 days a week, to accommodate all the men who wanted to enlist. Despite the massive amounts of men wanting to enlist, it became clear that enlistments alone would not supply enough men and women to support the war effort. Congress enacted a draft law in September of 1940. Joe Howell was one of these men who wanted to step up and defend his country by enlisting. However, he encountered several obstacles along the way.
When I heard about Pearl Harbor, my first reaction was that I should enlist right away. And my father talked me out of it, and as it turned out, I waited, and then I ended up, I was going to be drafted in the summer of '42.
Not wanting to be drafted, I tried to enlist, and there was a place where I could go in Beloit for the Navy, and the Navy wouldn't accept me because I'm not seen very well. I didn't have good vision. And so in August of '42, they started up a radio school in Janesville, Wisconsin, for people to get into radar when they got into the service.
Joe spent 12 weeks in radar school learning the basics of radar detection and tracking. He spent 24 additional weeks, 12 in Milwaukee and 12 in Chicago, receiving more specialized training. During his time in Chicago, he befriended some upperclassmen who became the bearers of some unfortunate news.
And when I was in that 12-week session in Chicago, we were getting feedback from some of the people that were in the class ahead of us that are, after all that radio training, when they got to Camp Crowder, Missouri, they would say, "We don't need any more radar people. Do you want to be a truck driver, a cook, or a message center clerk? You weren't going to use what you've learned." And so I applied for active duty. And I didn't get called the day after tomorrow, but I did get called in about 6 weeks. And sure enough, when I got to Camp Crowder, Missouri, in May of 43, you want to be a truck driver, message clerk, or whatever. And I chose to be a message center clerk.
Once Joe decided to become a message center clerk, he was sent to Camp Crowder, Missouri, where the majority of Signal Corps recruits received their training during World War II. Each man spent 3 weeks learning the basics of soldiering, such as drill, equipment, rifle marksmanship, and first aid. After completing basic training, men received more specialized training into logging incoming and outgoing messages, as well as encoding and decoding those messages. Once men had mastered these skills at Camp Crowder, they were divided into smaller groups that were to be assigned to work with specific branches. Joe's group was sent to California for physicals before they were sent to London to work with the 9th Air Force.
And after I had my message center basic training from my group, they took four of us and they sent us to California. And we were going to be assigned to the Air Force. And the day that the four of us arrived there, we were told that every Air Force base in the United States had gotten a telegram from Washington telling them to process as many men as they could, as fast as they could, irregardless of your training or whatever spec number you had, just they wanted bodies.
When Joe's time in California was complete, he was sent by train to Camp Kilmer in New Jersey, where he was to wait until he could be processed and finally sent overseas.
And so it took us a full week to go on a train from Fresno, California to New Brunswick, New Jersey. It took us 24 hours to go through the state of Colorado. We entered at the northwest corner, down to the southwest, across the south, up. We finally got through Colorado, and being a native of Beloit, I wanted to jump off the train when we went by Freeport because I knew I was only 25 miles from Beloit. And after 2 weeks there, they got us up one night, got us lined up outside the barracks, and we stood there for an hour from 9 until 10 o'clock at night in the rain, waiting. And we found out later that that 1 hour delay was because one man never showed up. And he finally showed up, but then we were processed.
Joe's training was long and time-consuming, but it was necessary to prepare him for his work with the Supreme Headquarters Allied Expeditionary Forces when he arrived in London. New York was his final destination before traveling overseas. As he and many other men stood in the New York Harbor, they experienced a few last moments of excitement as they discovered the legendary identity of the ship that would transport them to Europe.
We were in the greater New York area, get on a ferry boat and go up to the big harbor, and we went aboard what turned out to be the Queen Mary. And at that time, the Queen Mary was one of the fastest, most modern ships around. And we were really excited to think, oh boy, we're going over on the Queen Mary.
From the moment the Queen Mary was commissioned, it was apparent that she would go down in history. However, no one could have predicted that the reason for her fame would be the vital role she played during World War II. Construction started on the Queen Mary in Clydesdale, Scotland in 1930, but experienced a brief delay due to the economic setbacks of the Great Depression. In 1936, the Queen Mary departed from Southampton, England, and embarked on her maiden journey. In August of 1939, the U.S. military began to formulate big plans for the legendary ship. After the Nazi invasion of Poland that very same year, the U.S. military needed a ship that could transport a massive amount of troops quickly and efficiently to Europe. The Queen Mary's impressive size of 1,019 feet long and 12 decks high would allow the U.S. military to do just that. A crew was assembled to strip the ship of her luxurious amenities. After the Queen Mary was fully transformed and ready for military duty, she was often referred to as the Grey Ghost due to her stealth and new camouflage exterior. Soon after her conversion to the war effort, the Queen Mary was recognized as the largest and fastest troop ship to sail during the war. She was capable of transporting as many as 16,000 troops at 30 knots across the Atlantic. The decks were crowded and soldiers were packed aboard the ship with barely any room to spare. Joe has many vivid memories of his 7-day voyage to England on the Queen Mary.
We got on at the ground level and we marched up 4 flights of stairs on the Queen Mary, and we got onto what turned out to be the promenade deck. And then we were told, this is where you sleep. We didn't see any beds, we didn't see any cots. You were just supposed to lie down on the floor there, and that's where we were going to sleep. You couldn't even walk a straight line down the deck because you'd step on somebody's arm or foot, because we were all laying on our backs on the deck there. And we were never told officially, but we heard later that on our trip that there had been 14,000 troops.
Although there was some excitement from being on the Queen Mary, the crowded conditions and extreme temperatures on the ship made the men glad to finally arrive in Europe just a few days later.
And at that time, rather quickly after the invasion, the Americans and the Allies set up what they called the Chafe. And if you don't know what Chafe is the Chafe Supreme Headquarters Allied Expeditionary Forces.
The Supreme Headquarters Allied Expeditionary Forces were the main organizational force of Great Britain and the United States. The concept of Chafe started with the Allied Force Headquarters and the Chief of Staff to the Supreme Allied Commander. In 1944, these organizations were combined to form Chafe with the goal for more organization and coordination between the British and the Americans in the European theater. Each organization made a unique contribution to the final objectives of Chafe. The Allied Force Headquarters provided many training techniques which were vital during the combined operations where both U.S. and British soldiers were present. COSAC served as the nucleus for the Supreme Headquarters and dealt mainly with the organization and logistics of the war. Among the duties of Chafe were planning future Allied operations, distributing resources to troops, liberating countries as well as planning their reconstruction, and organizing a final plan for the defeat of Germany. Once Joe arrived in London, he was assigned the more specific message center job as a locations clerk, which was in charge of keeping track of the whereabouts of each man working as a part of Chafe.
I was specifically assigned as being a locations clerk. So we knew pretty much where everybody was, depending on the information that they gave to us. And the teletype machines were getting and receiving messages, and we were transmitting messages to other bases. And we would get a message that someone came in and that he was to be with APO, whatever it was, and then we would know that that was up near such and such a town or down here. They weren't all in London, of course.
During the time Joe worked in London, the Germans were waging an aerial war against the United Kingdom. The Battle of Britain left several towns and cities destroyed. Many people were evacuated to the country, but people who stayed in the cities had to take special measures to protect themselves from incoming bombs.
Our message center was off the same level of the Goode Street station underground. We were 140 feet underground. So when we were working, we were safe as could be, but then when we had to go home and sleep in the second floor of the brick barracks that they'd taken us to. And some of the men were, you had to practically drag them home from work to go home because they were happy to be safe in the underground. And when you would get on the subway to go to work or anything, or to go any place in London at that time, the people were sleeping on the deck next to the trains. The trains would come in, you would get on or off a train, and there was hardly room to walk because of all the people and all the arms spread out around there. But that's what they were doing.
Working underground provided a virtually bomb-proof location to protect the important communications that were being sent in and out of the signal center. Although Joe's job may at first seem small and unimportant, it was actually vital to the success of Chafe. Communication and organization brought even the slightest amount of order to the chaos of war and especially helped the U.S. and British work as a unified force. At times, working with the British was rough due to the different cultures and even a lack of communication in the beginning. When Joe first arrived in London, a small miscommunication caused a very large amount of confusion when trying to locate the barracks where he would be staying.
I don't know if any of you have been in London, but there's a very famous park in London known as Regent's Park. And the driver that was taking us to the Regent's Park Barracks couldn't find the Regent's Park Barracks. And one of the reasons he couldn't find it is that the Americans in the United States were referring our housing facility to be the Regent's Park Barracks. And the British people that lived around there, they knew nothing about it because to them, it was called the Albany Street Barracks. So it was quite a hectic deal to get there.
These interactions proved to be a very valuable learning experience. For many men who enlisted or were drafted, World War II was the first time they had traveled outside the United States and experienced a culture that was unique from America's. At times, the difference in cultures and customs caused slight frustrations towards the British men working with Joe as part of SHAFE.
When we were working in a combined message center, we had Canadians, we had British, and we had Americans. And it had yet to be a certain time, the Canadians and the British got up because it was tea time. You're in a war, you're fighting the enemy, and they'd all go out to have their tea and crumpets, you know. We didn't get a break like that. But that's the way the British did it.
After spending approximately 6 weeks in London, Joe was sent on a separate SHAFE mission where he was stationed in Belgium. Here, he continued his work as a locations clerk. During his time in Belgium, Joe and his friends used their time off to explore the city. While checking out a local business, Joe made a very unlikely discovery that would definitely make his time spent there worthwhile.
One of the things that we did in Brussels, if we had time, was to just go downtown, go in the shop, just looking around. They had things in the shops that you didn't see in London. And my wife owned a shop in Brussels where they sold furniture and not complete bedroom sets, but just unique pieces and so on, and lamps. And they had a lot of nice tableware, like dishes and so on. And I met her in that shop in downtown Brussels. And she was the owner, wanted to know what I wanted to buy, and I didn't want to buy anything. I was just looking around, you know. But that led to my inviting her out, and then we went out and so on and so forth.
We started to date when I was free, and at that point in time I proposed to the Mademoiselle Cannes, and we became engaged on the 14th of February, and we were subsequently married in a Catholic church in Brussels, Belgium. Say you'll be mine when the moon disappears.
Joe was also transferred to France, where he worked with the main signal battalion associated with SHAFE in Reims. During his time there, he got to experience a monumental moment of history. By the spring of 1945, the impending defeat of the German forces was clear. The Soviets were approaching Berlin from the east, and the Allied forces were approaching from the west. The bleak outlook of the war caused Hitler to commit suicide and leave his troops under the command of Karl Dönitz. Hitler left him hopelessly to finish fighting the war he had started. On May 2nd, the Soviets finally reached Berlin and conquered the city, causing 70,000 German troops to lay down their arms and surrender. Due to the failure of Nazi troops in Berlin, Dönitz lost all hope of fighting the Allied terms of unconditional surrender, which were previously defined by Prime Minister Winston Churchill and President Franklin D. Roosevelt at the Casablanca Conference in January of 1943. Dönitz therefore decided to accept the Allied terms of unconditional surrender on May 7th of 1945. The German surrender was made official the very next day with a formal signing ceremony. Joe Howell was one of the men on duty while the Germans signed the terms of surrender and ended the European conflict of World War II.
And I actually worked in that building, and I was on duty the night that the Germans surrendered.
But contrary to what the Beloit paper told everybody later, I was not in the same room where the surrender took place, but I was in the same building on duty at 2 o'clock in the morning when this all took place. And we knew when we went to work at midnight that night that the Germans were there and something big was going to happen. And when we got off work at 6 o'clock in the morning, we found out that the surrender had taken place.
As soon as the German surrender was announced, people in cities all over Europe flooded the streets and immediately began to celebrate. Street parties and parades were organized, and bands filled the streets with victorious music. Joe was in France on VE Day and got to celebrate this monumental occasion there. During his time overseas, Joe received many letters from his family, just like most soldiers during World War II. After the German surrender, he found himself with more time to respond to these letters and even describe in more detail about his experience to his family back home.
I had a family at home of a mother and a father and a grandmother and a sister. And there I was with a pencil pushing job in the army. And I was trying to answer the letters from all these people. We weren't even able to tell our parents what city we were in. And then after the Germans surrendered in May of 45, we could then write and tell them things that we hadn't been able to tell them before. I started writing installment letters in detail from when I first went over. So this is a letter that I wrote on the 24th of May. But I said, on Sunday night, June 18th, I went to bed about 12 o'clock.
Around 12:45, the alert sounded, and a few minutes later, we heard a buzz bomb approaching. The motor cut off while it was right over the barracks area, and it crashed about 100 yards from our room. About 10 minutes later, the first sergeant came to our room and said that a hospital had been hit, and they needed our help. We immediately got dressed and went over. We got over to the hospital about 20 minutes after 1 o'clock in the morning. The flying bomb had made a direct hit on this hospital, which to make matters worse was a hospital for people with mental diseases. There is a stretcher on the sidewalk with an old man on it. An ambulance driver for the National Fire Services was looking around for someone to help get this man to his ambulance. I picked one end up and we put the man in. Then I got back with this guy and away we went to another hospital. This man didn't appear to be in such bad shape, but he couldn't talk, or at least he didn't talk. When we got to the hospital, we took this guy in. There was red tape involved, and believe it or not, we had to wait about half an hour before we could leave the man. During this half hour, there were several other patients brought in from the bombed hospital. What I saw was difficult to describe, but it was far from a pleasant sight. By the time we got back to the bombed hospital, there were so many soldiers and the NFS men, so I went back, along with some other XS men, to the barracks. By that time, it was about 3 in the morning. The alert was still on, the buzz bombs were still coming in. I went up to my bed and laid down, but I didn't sleep very well for the rest of the night. Some of the patients I had seen had beams fall on them when the roof gave way. Every time I would hear a buzz bomb for the rest of the night, I'd roll out of my bed onto the floor and under the bed. I was more scared that night than any night since I'd been in the army. For the rest of June and all of July, we were getting buzz bombs around Regent's Parks pretty regularly. The different incidences and experience I have are too numerous to write about, but I will tell you more in subsequent letters. Loads of love.
After the Germans finally surrendered, Joe and the rest of his signal battalion were sent to Frankfurt, Germany to complete the final duty of Schaeff, which was to tie up the loose ends after the defeat of Germany. Just like before, Joe continued to work as a message center clerk, which was again vital to the success of all SHAEF operations.
After the Germans surrendered,
they took the whole Sigel battalion, and we were trucked in a convoy up to Frankfurt, Germany. And we worked in the communications battalion in Frankfurt, Germany until the war was over.
I actually could have gone home in December of 45, and because of the fact that I had married my wife, and she had a business that she couldn't walk out the day after tomorrow and say, I'm leaving. I signed up to get a six-month work assignment, and then my wife and I came back on the ship together.
When Joe returned home in 1945, he was welcomed as a war hero. The people on the home front did not care who served longer or what their job was. They were all welcomed the same. Families were happy to have their boys back on American soil and safe from harm. They recognized that each man's role was vital to the Allied victory. Joe and the other men working with him in their communication center were not in combat, but their role was just as important. Logistics and communications were vital to the success of the Allies. Without these, soldiers would not know where to go or what was going on. Many more lives would have been lost if men like Joe did not exist. Throughout this year, I have spent almost every day listening to Joe's story. And although I have only met him once, I feel as if I have known him for years. I will admit that I have sat in on interviews of veterans with more eventful stories than his, but that does not mean I value Joe's any less. His story is not filled with gunfire or death-defying feats. Not all veterans are. At the end of each interview, we ask each veteran what they think our generation can learn from theirs. Many reply with very short answers, or even none at all. What they don't realize is that they teach us without even knowing. Joe's story taught me that at times, the role we play may seem small and unimportant, but in the end, our actions can have a greater effect than we could ever imagine. I am so glad that I've had the opportunity to be part of this project. I can't think of anything I've worked harder on or been more dedicated to in my life. I will forever be changed by this experience and by Joe's story. Thank you, Joe.